Hi, Skiffin Lo Bates here, and Brian Mondoh tagged me in a post pointing me to an article explaining how the Poly Network hack happened and asked me what my opinion of this was. So I went to the article, and it explains in technical terms what went wrong with the Poly Network contracts. For those of you who don't know, it's a cross-chain collection of smart contracts that allow transactions between different blockchains, and it was hacked a day ago now, I think, for a sum of about 600 million, making it one of the biggest, if not the biggest, cryptocurrency and DeFi hacks in the history of this space. Now, the article is very technical, and the first thing I did after reading it and grasping what they were talking about was to go and look at the contracts that are mentioned. And there's the first red flag. These contracts can be looked up in Etherscan or in Binance Scan or in Polyscan. However, only the bytecode is available. The source code's not there. And when you submit a contract to the, say, Ethereum blockchain, you can also go to Etherscan, which is the blockchain explorer for Ethereum, and you can submit your code. And then Etherscan will verify that your code compiles to the bytecode that was submitted to the blockchain, and then they publish it so that anybody can look at it and audit it. So the fact that Poly Network didn't do this means that the code was less examined than it might have been. They've made it harder for people to check up on what's actually going on. Now, I would hope that the code is available somewhere online, but I haven't looked for it yet. So I'm just going to go with what the article said and try and explain it to you guys in a way that doesn't use lots and lots of confusing computer function names. And the basis of the system is that, to use an analogy, there's two parties. There's an accountant who has control over the bank accounts in which all the money is, and then there's a boss of that accountant. And what happens is people go to the boss and say, I want to conduct this transaction. The boss checks whether that is a valid transaction or not. And if it's a valid transaction, then the boss gives instructions to the accountant, who only answers to the boss and says, perform the following financial transactions for me. And that works all very well and good, except that it turns out there's a flaw in the boss and the accountant. The boss can tell the accountant, hey, look, I'm no longer your boss. This other guy over here is your boss. And so that's the first weakness. And the second weakness is that the boss can actually be hypnotized into making such an instruction to the accountant. So what the attacker did was they told the boss to tell the accountant that the boss is no longer the accountant's boss, but the attacker is the accountant's boss instead. And that went through, and now the attacker is in control of the accountant. And what the attacker then did was the attacker sent instructions for financial transactions to the accountant that simply drained money out of the bank accounts, rather than doing what the proper boss did, which is check that for every sum taken out of one bank account, it was credited into the correct other bank account. So that, in non-technical terms, is how the attack worked. And we've seen these kind of things before, where loopholes are left in smart contracts to do with who owns them. And in the past, it was that the core contract would have a publicly callable function that would allow anybody to take control of it. This one's a two-step one. The second contract will only accept a new owner from the first contract, but now the first contract had published the functionality that allowed the changing of that owner instruction to go through to the second contract. So, as I said, imagine it as an accountant and a boss, and the boss could be convinced to tell the accountant that somebody else was now the boss of the accountant. And the effect of that is that the attacker took control of contract that allowed you to move funds around in any way you liked. And I'm guessing here that the architecture was that they would have a kind of base contract that can do financial actions, and then they'd have a second contract that verified which transaction should be passed through to it. And that's where the weakness was, the fact that the ownership of the second one could be changed by using the first one. So a two-step attack, but a very interesting one, and also a very unfortunate one. I'll put a link to the article in the comments below, or maybe even in the body of this post, and then you'll be able to see that it's actually not that easy to understand unless you understand the computer technology. Most people's eyes will just glaze over when they see all the names of the various functions, which are at first reading comprehensible. Anyway, I hope you found this interesting. One final thing I would like to add. This is the Poly network that got hacked, and that's a collection of smart contracts running on the Ethereum and the Polygon Matic and the Binance chains. It's not actually anything to do with the Polygon network, and I feel a bit sorry for the Polygon network guys, because some of the people I've talked to were under the impression that the Polygon network, the Polygon Matic blockchain was actually hacked, and that was not the case. It's apps running on top of it. So this is the same as the Parity wallet hack or some of the other hacks that we've seen in essence. What was the other point I wanted to make? I can't remember it. Well, if it comes to me, I'll make another video. See you in that one soon. Bye for now.